CYC is a free channel that presents the Word of God for everyone. Your support will help us to continue the mission. Visit our website, cycnow.com. Even a dollar will make a difference.
The orientation of the monk is towards heaven, toward the life of another world. They are frequently referred to as earthly angels. What is more blessed than to imitate the chorus of angels here on earth? For this reason, we will try to highlight the monastic vocation, which may answer some of the questions the youth may have. Here and from St. Mary in St. Moses Abbey, Corpus Christi, Texas, we are very blessed to have Abuna Daniel with us. Thank you, Abuna, for being with us today. We wanted to know more about the monastic rites in the Coptic Church.
The monastic rites, or the rites of ordination, start off with the evening prior to the monk getting ordained into being a monk, or into monasticism. So the evening before, the monk will receive his name, and he will also take his vow in front of the altar, in front of his father of confession, in front of the bishop, if the bishop is present, or in our case, if the bishop is the father of confession. He'll take it in front of all the novices and fathers of the monastery, in front of all the saints of the monastery. And after he takes his vow, the bishop, or the one consecrating the monk, will give the monk, or give the novice, the name that he will have in his monastic life as a monk. After he receives his name, prayers are dismissed, and the candidate who is going to be ordained, God willing, the next day, will stay in the church.
And he will keep vigil all night, reflecting on spiritual things and on the life that he's about to enter into. Obviously, he will be praying for strength and grace from God to be able to complete this vow successfully and in a way that is pleasing to God. And then the next morning, the monk will participate, or the candidate for monasticism will participate in the midnight praises. He will participate in morning raising of incense. And then after morning raising of incense is when the actual consecration ceremony occurs, in which they do the funeral prayers. So the monk will be placed underneath a veil, and the funeral prayers will be prayed on this monk. And they will read many different prophecies and many different readings, talking about preparing yourself for this particular life that you're going to enter into. Wisdom of Sirach is read, in which it said, if you want to draw closer to the Lord, prepare yourself for temptation. So it's readings to help the candidate for monasticism be focused and to understand and to keep in mind that this vow that he is about to take is a life of struggle, and he will need to be very serious about it in order to complete it successfully and in a way that is pleasing to God. And so after these readings are completed, they will remove the veil from the monk. He will stand up. His father of confession will ask him one last time, are you sure that monasticism is for you? Is this the path that you feel you're being called to, and do you want to continue on this? If he responds yes, then the one performing the ordination will continue to perform the rites, and he will dress the candidate in his monastic garments, the galabeya, the kolon soa, and then he will officially be a monk by the name that he was named the night before, and then they will immediately go into the Divine Liturgy, and they will celebrate the Divine Liturgy, and the monk will participate in Divine Liturgy, and then afterwards he'll return to his cell. Once the liturgy is dismissed, he will return to his cell, and typically what the monk is supposed to do is he is supposed to take the next 3 days, and he is not to work at all. So, for example, if he had a job before he was ordained a monk, like, for example, if he was in the kitchen while he was a novice, Once he is ordained, he is excused from the kitchen and all his other responsibilities as far as work goes. Mm-hmm. He's excused from them for 3 days. Mm-hmm. And he spends those 3 days staying in his cell, reflecting on the new life that he's been brought into, and spending the time in prayers and entreating God to give him strength to be able to successfully complete his vows, mm-hmm. and to be strong and to live a life that is pleasing to God. And then after those 3 days, then he will return back to his normal responsibilities and will perform his work duties and whatever other duties that he's been assigned.
What are the garments of the monk mean, the kolon soa?
The kolon soa, well, actually the garment was handed down to the monks through an angel. When St. Anthony was in the desert, he was afflicted by boredom, mm-hmm. and he asked God what he should do. So God told him, go out and outside of your cave, and you will see what you need to do. And once he stepped outside of his cave, he saw an angel sitting down and working a little bit with his hands, doing some handicrafts. Then the angel would stand, he would pray for a while, then he would sit again and he would do some handicraft work. And so we showed him, Antonius, that you should live a life of prayer and work. And so you'd work a little and you'd pray a little bit. And then he also gave M. Antonius the monastic garments. He gave him the galabeya, or the cassocks, and he gave him the kolon soa, or the cowl. The cassocks doesn't necessarily have any meaning as far as like it's a full body thing other than modesty, but also the color black is relevant because it helps us keep in mind that we are dead to the world and represents death. So it lets others know that we are dead to the world, and it reminds us that we are also supposed to be dead to the world, and keeps that focus in our mind. And the kolon soa was given. It has 12 crosses, six on each side, and those represent the 12 apostles or 12 disciples. And then there's a single cross in the back that represents our Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's supposed to represent that the monk is supposed to have, as St. Paul says, the mind of Christ. Mm-hmm. So it's supposed to remind us to have sanctified thoughts. Mm-hmm. So that's the purpose of the kolon soa. And there's a stitching down the middle. There are two stories that I've heard about this, and they both involve St. Anthony. One is that in both cases he was confronted by the devil, and the devil was very upset with St. Anthony, and he said, I'm very frustrated that he can't overcome you. And so one story is that he hit St. Anthony across the top of the head. Mm-hmm. Another story that I heard is that he ripped the kolon soa in half, and then St. Anthony stitched it back together. But in either case, he had a confrontation with the devil, and the devil was very upset with St. Anthony. And this can just be a reminder in either case that either he was hit or the devil tore it. It still reminds us that the devil confronted St. Anthony, and that the devil is constantly confronting all the monks and warring against them. And it can help us stay focused on that we have someone that's warring against us, and we again have to be very serious in our spiritual lives.
Sometimes the devil, I'm sure the devil actually is very persistent, tempting all the monks, that really decided to follow this path and to attain salvation. Can you give us some example about those kind of temptations in general?
I think that the temptations in the monastery, they can vary from monastery to monastery, and they can also vary depending on what particular mode of life you're living. For example, a monk who is living in the communal setting would have different challenges and temptations than a monk that is living the solitary life away in a cave many miles from civilization. But some obvious things are, in the community, you obviously have to learn how to deal and get along with your fathers and brothers here at the monastery when you live in the community. So that could be one trial or temptation that the monk could be confronted with living in the community, that he has to learn how to be able to both do the things that he's been assigned to do and do the things that he wants to do if they're spiritual, but at the same time be able to compromise if it's going to be in conflict with someone else. Or for example, if I needed to use a particular father to help me on my job responsibility, but then another father needed him as well, I have to be able to compromise and say, okay, why don't we allow Abuna to go with you for 30 minutes and then I can use him 30 minutes later. Whereas a monk living the solitary life, he could be confronted more with things like anger, for example. I know there was a story in the Paradise of the Fathers about a monk who went to live a solitary life, and when he was living in his cave, the devil came and pushed over a cup that was filled with water, and it made the solitary very angry, and he got upset at the cup and had this anger burning inside of him. So he was attacked with anger, whereas he wouldn't be attacked with having to deal with other people's needs and conflict of needs because he's by himself.
I see. Okay, what are some of the spiritual practices that a monk will implement in his daily life toward spiritual growth?
There are many different ways to grow spiritually. I think that the point is to make sure that you have the same aim or goal. The virtues are compared many times to fruit. And so our goal is to bear this fruit of all the virtues and to bear the fruit of the Spirit. And it says in the Gospel of John chapter 15 that the way to do this is to abide in the true vine, or to abide in Christ. So the goal is just to abide in Christ, but there are many different ways to do this. You can do this through attending liturgy on a frequent basis. You can do this by attending midnight praises. You can do this by maybe staying in your cell, and if you're good at art, you can draw icons in your cell, and it's just a way that you can keep your mind on Christ. Maybe you can memorize a bunch of psalms, and as you're walking around the monastery, you can constantly be reciting these psalms. The aim is to just make sure that you abide in Christ at all times, so that by abiding in Him you bear much fruit. But there are many different ways to abide in Christ. Perhaps maybe someone will have a picture that they will carry around in their pocket of Christ, and maybe many times throughout the day they'll pull it out, and seeing this picture of Christ will help them abide in Christ and think about Christ, and they'll bear fruit. Maybe another person has the tattoo of the cross on his hand in either of the two common places, and so throughout the day he can look at the cross, and this is his way of abiding with Christ. The point is just to abide in Christ and live your life with Him constantly, so that through abiding in Christ constantly, you will bear all of these fruits.
Thank you, Abuna, for being with us today.
It's my blessing.
This is really an unusual journey. There are no maps, timetables, or even travel arrangements, but there is only one destination, the Kingdom of Heaven. Thank you for being with us today, and see you next time.